Hello and welcome back. I'm Alex Darisel. I'm joined here by Aditya Thiyag. Aditya, how are you doing today?
I'm all right, man. How are you?
I'm not bad. So before we get into the episode here, we're going to kind of get you warmed up with a few easy questions. So first off, favorite flavor of ice cream?
Favorite flavor of ice cream? If we're talking like graters, I think birthday cake is very underrated. Mm-hmm. I really like it. But I also am a pretty big fan of just classic cookies and cream. Cookies, you can't go wrong with that.
Yeah.
Special shout out to cookie dough, because that's also hits.
Yeah. So is it, do you have, like, if you had to go to ice cream place, would you automatically choose Grater's or?
Yeah, Grater's is kind of my go-to here. Like, I'll go with my friends a lot. I know a lot of people during the summer go to, like, Whippy Dip because they're a big fan of soft serve. And I like the soft serve. They make these, like, ice cream sandwiches, and you can choose whether or not you want, like, cookies or wafers.
Yeah.
And I love the ones they make with cookies. They're just – they're so good. It's really great. Mm-hmm. So I do really like Whippy Dip, but I'm a bigger fan of Grater's.
All right. I can respect that. So kind of next kind of – icebreaker question here for you. What is your, if you could be any animal in the world, what animal would you be?
Okay, so I have two answers to this question. Mm-hmm. The first one is I would be a grizzly bear, because grizzly bears are just vibes. Like, they can climb trees, they can, I almost confused grizzly bears and polar bears, because polar bears can swim 6 miles per hour, but grizzly bears love catching fish. I love grizzly bears. I know they're, like, 10 feet tall and, like, claws, and they're, like, scary, but they are very gentle creatures. Mm-hmm. I think they embody the whole mentality of, like, if you leave me alone, I promise I'll leave you alone.
Yeah.
And the other one is a very weird one. It's called the shoebill stork. It's 5 feet tall. Its wingspan is 8 feet. It is friends with hippos, and it fights crocodiles for fun. Oh. And it is not the kind of stork that brings babies, but it is very cool. And the coolest thing about it is, if you've ever seen Harry Potter and you know about hippogriffs, which are these majestic beasts where if you bow to them, they'll let you, like, climb on top of them. That, I don't know if Rowling actually thought of shoebill storks, but if you bow to a shoebill stork, they'll bow back to you and let you pet them. They're very friendly to humans.
Wow, so, definitely not the type that delivers babies, but special in their own way. So kind of getting into the episode here a little bit, you know, you obviously, your family is from India, and, you know, as me and Aditya met, you know, 4 years ago in freshman media class, and so, you know, through the years we've developed our relationship since, so I've got a little bit of background information on him. And so, you know, you weren't always in Mason. So can you talk to me a little bit and, you know, tell me your story of how, you know, your family came to the States and where you came before Mason?
So I've actually moved a crazy amount of times. I think it's close to like 11. Mm-hmm. It's all been within the United States. I was born in Indianapolis. We moved to like Connecticut. We actually came to Mason when I was 2 years old, but then we left later.
Yeah.
Like, we've been all over the place. The place that I've like most connected with, I've spent the longest in Mason, but I still have a connection to the time when I lived in Chicago. Mm-hmm. Like, I have a lot of close friends here. I'm very in love with, like, the city, the aesthetic, and I hope to go there for college, actually. But I'm a huge fan of Chicago. That is somewhere that largely shaped who I am today. But, like, tying back into more, like, my family, they actually were born and raised in India. And they moved to the States in, like, 2002, 2001, so a couple years before I was born. And, like, that was really big because, like, not only were they leaving their family to move to another country, they were broke when they landed here, and they didn't know anyone, right? And, like, it was my parents told me this story, and it was so vividly in my head. So they landed in D.C., and there was an airport taxi that was supposed to take them to, like, a specific apartment. They already had it all planned out, right? And they told me that when they were driving home, it was at night, and all they saw was, like, red and white and all darkness. And I was so confused because I didn't know what they meant. And then they were like, we didn't know what was going on because we saw red lights, white lights, and darkness. And I realized that they were talking about the red car headlights in front of them and then the white headlights on the left side of them. And then it was just dark all around. Because, like, in India, right, like, when it gets dark, obviously, like, it gets pretty dark. You can't really see anything. But there are lights. And on top of that, like, everything's very clustered together. And so there's never really that like, open setting where it's just thousands of cars like that.
Yeah.
So I think, like, obviously, that's something that living in the United States, like, we kind of, I won't say take it granted for, but, like, we're not.
It's just something we're accustomed to.
We're accustomed to it, yeah. And so, like, I just think it's crazy how even little things like that ended up shaping them on their journey here.
Yeah, well, I mean, that's an incredible, you know, kind of backstory, if you will, to your kind of life, how your parents came here and, you know, how they've, you know, became successful in their own, you know, respective fields and stuff like that. So kind of going to you now, you know, you have this, like you mentioned, you have a connection to Chicago. Do you have a connection back to where your parents are from? And have you ever, you know, visited or do you still have family over in India?
So pretty much my entire family outside of my parents live in India. Besides my cousin who lives now in California, actually. And it's been weird because I speak Tamil, which is my native language. It's actually, I think, the second oldest language in the world, which is really cool.
Yeah.
But I speak it and I can understand it, listen to it, but I can't read or write. And that automatically, and I don't speak it as fluently. So it puts me at a bit of a disconnect from my relatives. Like my mom's mom, she doesn't speak any English, right? So that, I, like, had to learn it for that purely. But it's not, like, forced. I'm obviously not the most fluent, but I can carry a conversation. I can understand. But I think the biggest thing with, like, being Indian but being raised in America is I feel like when I go back to India, I do visit. I try to visit every couple years. We were supposed to go in 2020, and there was a small pandemic. I don't know if you heard about it.
It's like probably threw off your plans just a little bit.
But yeah, not
as everyone else.
Yeah. So we do plan on going next year, though. So I'm excited for that. But every time I visit, I try to just absorb like every second of culture that I can, because like that time is really precious, because I FaceTime my relatives, but I know like a lot of people here, like they get to see their family for Thanksgiving or they visit grandma's house every weekend.
Yeah.
Or they have them for Christmas. Like I see them like once every couple of years max. And it's tough because I do really care about them and they do really care about me. And even though like when I speak English, it sounds foreign to them because they speak a little more broken. Right. It's still like we still have that love for each other regardless of the language.
Yeah.
But like another thing that's different is despite like me having a connection back to India, like I honestly feel it's different being in Mason as like an Indian student. Obviously, we do have a large Indian and Asian population. Right. But I feel like especially the Indian kids tend to cluster together, and it's a group that it's just a very clustered group of people.
Yeah.
And I feel like it's not everyone in that cluster, as I don't expect them to, are very in touch with their culture. So I feel like a lot of the time, like when you see groups assimilating with each other, they're discussing their culture. It's more like, hey, we're both brown, let's sit together and talk. And that's cool. I think it's cool. It's just, I think it's a lot harder to find people like super in touch with their culture here, and that can kind of put me at a disconnect when I'm involved in things like mridangam, which is an Indian instrument that I play, and like when I'm involved in that, like it makes me feel a little more connected to my culture. But like not everyone has that, so it's hard to
relate
conversations.
And you mentioned, I didn't know this about you, you play the, what is the instrument
it's called? The mridangam.
Mridangam.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, that's perfect actually.
What is it? Can you kind of like describe it so I kind of get a mental image for anyone else listening?
So it's like a drum.
Okay.
like, I think the best way to describe it is, like, have you seen, like, a bongo? Like, where they have a drum straight up and down, and then you play on the top. So imagine a bongo, but it's sideways. There are drums on both sides. Okay. And you play with your hands. Uh-huh. So not with your drum, not with, like, sticks. Or something. So you just play that. It's actually, like, you can play it solo. I play it because my best friend, Rishi, he got me into it. Mm-hmm. He's so talented at it. I love him so much, but, like, he's the reason I got into it. And a lot of the times, like, when you hear it in, like, classical Indian songs, it's, like, an accompanying instrument. The same way that, like, drums aren't, like, the focal point of any particular song.
Yeah.
But, like, you can hear, like, in bands and stuff, it's still something steady that adds to the performance. Yep. So that's what the mridangam is meant to be.
Yeah. So we kind of looked at, you know, your backstory, you know, your past, a little bit of your present, and, you know, kind of going forward, you know, what's next? You know, is college in the cards for you? You know, if so, where do you want to go? Your dream school, kind of like that.
I really want to go back to Chicago. My dream school is Northwestern, which is, it's like a scary thing to say because, like, it's a really hard school to get into. But, like, I think I want to write. I want to do journalism. Mm-hmm. Like, I would love to be in that field purely because I enjoy writing a lot. Like, I'm on the Chronicle.
Yes. Very talented too.
That's for my editor to say, Brad. No, but I really enjoy writing. I think the being able to bring other people's stories to the limelight is very nice. And I'm a huge arts, culture, and entertainment fan. Mm-hmm. So I would love to write about that as well because I feel like the arts are so underappreciated in their relevancy because, like, that is the purest form of human expression in my eyes. Like, you might be able to learn, like, math from a textbook, science from a textbook. You can't really learn culture from a textbook.
Yeah.
You learn culture by, like, sort of experiencing it. You know what I mean? Like, listening to a specific culture's music, tasting their food. So I think being able to share my experiences with culture for people who might not be able to experience it, I think is just a cool thing that I'd be able to do. And for that, I want to be in a bigger city like Chicago. Mm-hmm.
And so, kind of backtracking here, just for a second, you have your own podcast, the Croncast, and, you know, very good. And we will link some videos and stuff in this video towards the end here. But does that kind of flow into what you were just saying there about sharing other people's stories and bring them into the limelight, or is that a little bit different there?
Yeah, no. So we've done a couple episodes on the Croncast. I don't know when this video is going to go up, but I do really want to do one with you pretty soon. But so far, the couple episodes we have done have definitely been more entertainment centric. Like, I did an episode on Squid Game and Silk Sonic with my co-host Mishra, and I did very recently a Spider-Man episode for the release of No Way Home with Lydia Lisco. Yeah. I'm really excited for that. And
are we all?
And, like, yeah, I am trying. The Croncast was just, like, the first episode I did it, I was just like, let me try this podcasting thing, and I really fell in love with it. So I think, because I love to talk. But I think, like, I really appreciate you using your platform as a way to, like, interview people and bring out those stories. But I feel like my podcast, while I would want to do that from time to time because it's something I'm passionate about, I feel like the Croncast will be more like what I'm observing in the world around me in terms of entertainment, in terms of culture, what I feel in the heat of the moment that I want to talk about.
Yeah. Well, like I said, be sure to check it out. We will be adding, you know, a way to get to the video somewhere on this podcast. And so, kind of one final question here for someone, you know, like me or anyone else listening that wants to, you know, approach someone that is, you know, from a different background, a different culture, whatever it might be, what is the best way to do that, you know, respectfully, just so that, you know, you can kind of have that conversation?
I think that, honestly, approaching someone and asking about their culture is already the first step because it shows not only a sign of empathy, but it shows respect. It shows interest. It shows that someone cares about you enough that they want to learn more, not only about you as a person, but your culture, where you come from. So I think that first step, like, obviously there's a way to it, but first I want to commend you and other people who are taking that first step, because it's not an easy thing to do. But if you were to approach someone, I'd say the biggest thing is try to remember that this person, like, they aren't a spokesperson for their culture. Mm-hmm. Like I said before, like, I'm not the most fluent in my language, and even though I am an Indian person and I know a little bit about what we do, like, I'm not the Wikipedia page, you know what I mean? So treat them like a human being first. They might not know all the answers, but just be respectful, be kind. Don't make this person feel like they're the poster child or the representative, but just talk to them. I'm sure they'll understand that, like, hey, I'm not trying to just, like, only learn about your culture and not you as a human being. Yeah. Like, I'm just trying to learn an aspect about what makes you you, and if you don't know, that's okay. We'll figure it out together.
Yeah. Well, that's, you know, really beautiful to hear you say that, and something I think we can all learn, myself included. So, you know, that kind of wraps up this, you know, episode, and, you know, wherever you end up, you know, next year, whether that's, you know, Northwestern or anywhere else, you know, we wish you the best of luck, and be sure to tune in next week as we're going to wrap up our the first season, I guess, of the interview. And thanks, Aditya, for coming on.
Thank you, man. I love being here.
Yep. And we, like I mentioned, we will have some way to get to Aditya's
Chromecast. We'll leave it in the description or something.
Yep. All right. Thanks, and be sure to tune in next week.